Hello, and thank you for joining Freedom Church Online. I'm Christian, and as part of the team, it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you today to our online service. Our heart is a church family, and our prayer is that you feel part of us as we come together, whether that's in person or online, to worship Jesus and to be fed from God's word. Today, we have Brian Early speaking to us. Brian lives in Oregon in the USA with his wife, and he's a retired Baptist minister. He opens our series that we're just about to start on women in the Bible. And he has entitled his talk, Sarah, Waiting on Her Promise, Keeping God. He looks at her life and expands on these three questions. Firstly, can we lose our sense of security in God to take care of us? Can we try to figure out things on our own? And can we lose our hope in God's promises? First, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that through Jesus we can come into your presence, Lord. We are here to worship you. We are here ready for you to speak to us, Lord. So Holy Spirit, we ask that you come and be Lord over this time. And we ask that you come and impart your truth to us. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Our Bible reading is Proverbs 31:10. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like a merchant ship, bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it's still night. She provides food for her family and portions for her female servants. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks. She sees her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. Now it's time to worship Jesus, the Son of God, the one whom, through him, life has been given in all its fullness.
What are you turning to wine? Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God. Our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God. Our God. Thank you. is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who can stand against? Stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And what can stand against?
Prayer is crucial for the life of the church, and on Tuesday evenings we hold our prayer evening. And this particular Tuesday it's going to be a vigil for Ukraine. Because in these days it's absolutely vital that we pray. We serve a God who wants us to invite him into all of our troubled situations. And so we pray as the Spirit leads, but like I said, especially for Ukraine at this time. Because we serve a God who hears and answers our prayers. So you are more than welcome to join us. It's from 8 p.m. and it's on Zoom, as I said, Tuesday evening. But whether or not you can make it, please do keep Ukraine in your prayers. We'll also be holding communion and prayer, and that will be on a Monday and a Tuesday and a Friday during this Lent period. The link and those details are in our YouTube bio. But now it's time to hear what God is saying through Brian, talking about the life of Sarah, Abraham's wife.
Hello, Freedom Church. It's my privilege once again to share God's word with you. When Paul asked me to consider giving a message on one of the women in the Bible, I had to think, well, I've never done this before. I've never had a particular series that I've done on the women of the Bible. So this is a fresh message, talk. That is directed specifically to what God would want me to say to you. So it is my prayer that her life and the struggles she had, as well as the struggles that we face, are similar, but yet her life was one that reflected what's seen in the title that I've given this talk, the Sarah waiting on her promise-keeping God. I'd like to introduce this by sharing from Hebrews chapter 11. We know this as what we call the Hall of Faith, that place where a number of the people in the scriptures were given as those who had lived victoriously, yet through difficulties and tragedies and great uncertainties, lived their faith out and can be counted as those that we can look to and go, there's somebody, a human, another person, who by God's grace and design has lived this life as God had designed it by faith. And so starting at verse 8, I want to read this introduction of Abraham and of Sarah. It says, by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as a in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac, and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. For he was looking for a city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, even Sarah herself received ability to conceive, even beyond the proper time of life, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Three times in this passage we see the word promise mentioned, and obviously faith and faithfulness are mentioned here as well. But the faith that God has given us to live is based on, in part, his faithfulness to us. And so Abraham and Sarah had been given promises by God. And what we will see is they had to wait to see these promises fulfilled. And so waiting on her promise-keeping God. So what does it mean that God promises us? What does that mean in terms of our life? What does he promise us? And we know he promises us a lot of things. Life for God, you know, in godliness, promises that maybe he has spoken directly to us through the Holy Spirit, or in some fashion he has said, I want you to be this way. I want you to go this way. I've called you to live for me in this way. And as a result, there's promises that he will provide that give us the assurance that he's alongside of us along the way. But this is based in part on what we believe, that God is reliable and he's faithful to do what he said he's going to do. And let's just face it, what if these promises require us to wait to see these promises fulfilled? So when we look at the life of Sarah in Genesis, we see three things that I'd like us to kind of engage in and understanding that I think relate to us. Three things in her life that we deal with as well. And so think of our life as it relates to Sarah's life in this way. We can lose security in God to take care of us. Does that sound familiar at all? We can try to figure out things on our own and compromise God's will for our lives. And thirdly, we can lose hope and forget that our Heavenly Father is a God of promise. And so as we approach these verses, you know, the scriptures always give us the understanding that they were meant for our good and that we can glean from them to see how we can live as others have lived before us. And so we're called to be recognizing God's faithfulness. We're called to live under that faithful hand that guides us. And so today, as we think through this, let's start in chapter 10 of Genesis. And we're going to work our way through certain sections in the Genesis account that show Sarah's life to us. I hope they provide you encouragement. As we begin, we see that the scriptures unfold from when Noah was and his sons made their landing and resettlement of the earth. And in chapter 10, we see that taken place. And then we see specifically the descendants of Shem related to his descendants all the way down to chapter 11, verse 26, where we see a man named Terah described. And Terah lived, as it says in verse 28, in the land of Ur of the Chaldeans. This is a place what we would consider today in Iraq, near the confluence of the Tigris and Euphrates River, just south of where Babel and then Babylon were developed. And in verse 29, we read this. And Abraham and Nahor took wives for themselves. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai. By the way, I should pause here. At this point, Abraham and Sarah were called by their original names, Abram, which means father, and Sarai, which means princess. And Nahor, his wife, Milcah, is the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah and Iscah. And Sarah, verse 30, was barren and had no children. Very important here. This is a key in this whole process. Being barren was certainly not something that any woman would want. That stigma was much stronger back then than maybe it is now, that if you weren't able to have children, you were frowned upon, looked down upon. But it really fits into how God's going to operate in his miraculous way to see through and pass that to make his work done. In verse 31, it says, "And Terah took Abram his son, and Lot the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went out together from Ur of the Chaldeans in order to enter the land of Canaan. And they went as far as Haran, and they settled there. The days of Terah were 250 years, and Terah died in Haran." So what we've got here is this clan leaves Ur of the Chaldeans and moves northward in their progression towards coming back into what we now call Israel, but the land of Canaan. God had given a call to Abram, in chapter 12. And this is kind of looking backwards as we get into chapter 12 of that call that spurred Terah to take his family, in a sense, halfway. Then we see Abram, move them the rest of the way. Okay, so here's the setting. God, it says in verse 1 of chapter 12, "Now the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country," that's the land of the Chaldeans, "and from your relatives and from your father's house and to the land which I will show you. I will make you a great nation," meaning there's going to be children from you, "and I will bless you, and I will make you a great name. And so you will be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you, I will curse. And you will, and all the families of the earth shall be blessed." And so Abram gets this call, this vision of God's leading and prompting to go to the promised land. And so it begins in chapter 11 with Terah. And then after Terah dies, it says in verse 4 of chapter 12, "So Abram went forth as the Lord had spoken to him." And so they went on. And so as we continue to read in chapter 12, I'll just summarize. They make it to the promised land. They survey it. God talks to them about it and saying, you know, this is the place where I'm going to have you be. But because there's a famine in the country, they move on to Egypt. And here brings us to this first point that I want us to process, is that we can lose security in God to take care of us. So notice what happens here in chapter 12, starting at verse 10. They go to the land of Egypt, and it says in verse 10, "Now the land was, there was famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. And it came about when he came to Egypt that he said to Sarai, his wife, 'See, now I know that you are a beautiful woman, and it will come about that when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife, and they'll kill me. But they will let you live. Please say that you're my sister so that it may go well with me because of you and that I may live on account of you.'" And so that's what they did. Now, talking to my wife, who, by the way, it's kind of difficult for a guy to preach about a girl because certainly things are a little different in terms of how you view things. And this would be one of them. And as I asked my wife to help me review her thoughts on this, immediately she said, "If I was Sarah, I'd be mad. Why would you want me to compromise? Why would you want me to say this to save your neck?" And in a sense, if both of them had had their minds fixed on God, they would have trusted God and seen that God could take care of them. And he did take care of them. But in this particular instance right now, they're being tested in their faith, and they lose security in God. And so they have to play this game, which, by the way, they were brother and sister, partly. They were half brother and sister. Terah was their father by two different mothers. So they weren't really telling a lie fully. White lie, or call it what you want. But the issue here is that I think both of them lost security in God. And so what ends up happening, they say this when they go in and people say, wow, look at this beautiful woman. We ought to bring her before Pharaoh, and Pharaoh can have her as a wife. And so they did exactly that. And then when God basically in a dream, in a vision, struck Pharaoh's house, and plagues came about on his life, and then he realized, whoa, this guy told me a lie. This woman's telling me a lie. They are husband and wife. Why didn't you tell me this in the first place? And so anyway, he sends them on their way, and he gets them out of their hair before anything else could happen to him in terms of plagues. But the issue here is simply this. How do we lose security in how God takes care of us? When we're frightened, I want you to think about when we get frightened, our minds operate sometimes at a different speed and a different, we get into fight or flight mode. We get into a different mood that sometimes we take our eyes off of God and we kind of forget God's there for us. And I think that's what happened when they entered in. They came into what they would consider, I guess, a threat. And so how do we, when we get into that mindset, need to get back to thinking that God's there to take care of us? And indeed he did. He did it another way. He could have probably done it the same way without them lying, huh? So, I want us to really think first, is the security in God, even when times are tough, when difficulties come, or when things come at us that threaten us, do we lose security that God can take care of us along the way? So that's the first point we see in Sarah's life that could be like ours in the issue of seeing God faithful in his promises. You got to realize, he said, I'm going to make you a great nation. So if God's going to make them a great nation through their offspring, why be afraid when they come into Egypt? But they were, they did, and frankly, so do we. Well, moving on, chapter 13, they move back into the promised land where God had called them. And so in that process, then we're going to skip on through all the way to chapter 16 to then begin to see the second point I want us to see in Sarah's life, or Sarai's life. And that is, we can try to figure things out on our own, or we can try to compromise God's will for our life. I want you to pick up with me starting at verse 1 of chapter 16. It says, now Sarai, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maid whose name was Hagar. Now I've got this point here that Abraham right now is 85 years old. This is about 10 years after the promise. So they've been going along all this time, waiting, hoping, and trusting that God's going to provide a child, but yet no child after 10 years. And so Sarai is getting a little bewildered and wondering, maybe we got this wrong. Maybe we got to do this a different way than just me and Abraham, my husband, having children. So verse 2, it says, Sarai said to Abram, now behold, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. He's blaming it on God. He's keeping me from having children. So please go into my maid. Perhaps I shall obtain children through her. In other words, her child is my child. Abraham listened to the voice of Sarai. And after Abram lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Abram's wife Sarah took Hagar, the Egyptian, her maid, and gave her to her husband Abram as his wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress was despised in her sight. And Sarah said to Abram, may the wrong done me be upon you. I gave you my maid into your arms, but when she saw she had conceived, I was despised in her sight. May the Lord judge between you and me. Now she's blaming this on Abraham, even though she's the one who started this. And so I want you to think about this. If you believe God has called you to do something, or maybe God is showing you through scriptures, which is really where a lot of the promises of God are. Do we compromise? Do we try to do it on our own? And one of the ways I think we do that sometimes is how we may choose a mate, and how we know that God wants us to be equally yoked, but somehow we figure we got to do it a different way. Maybe I will win that person to Christ, and they'll come to Christ, and you know, in other words, we'll be happy because I know better in this. I'm just using this as one example of how sometimes we try to figure out God's will for our life based on compromise or going a level less than what we know is what God would want for us in the best of life. Sometimes we do things in our own strength or our own thinking. I'm going to do it my way, and I know God's going to bless. I've heard that so many times where people, when they're trying to figure out God's will for their lives, they sometimes will say, I think God led me to do this, when it's in total opposition to the Word of God. And somehow they believe God's promise can be twisted enough to figure out how to make it work for them. And I just want to caution you, be careful about that. Now, God worked things out here, even though Sarah tried to twist things up. Now, just keep this in mind. Hagar had a child, and his name was Ishmael. And if we know anything about Ishmael, he was the line of what we now call the Arabs, which is also then the line of the Islamic faith. So this would be the one of the three major religions of the world. Judaism, obviously, here when we're thinking about this, Christianity coming through this, but Islam as well, through the line of Ishmael. But we know the Ishmaelites were a thorn in the flesh to the line of Isaac and Jacob, etc. And so there was button of heads and conflicts and stuff along the way. Not to say that God wouldn't have done that hadn't Hagar been presented to Abraham. But I think you get the drift here. When we try to do things our way, sometimes things get messed up. And sometimes we think we know better than God along the way. Now let's move on to chapter 17. Abraham, in chapter 17, it says in verse 1, is 99 years old. So this is 24 years since the initial promise that God gave. They're still waiting for a child 24 years later. Wow. Now God speaks to Abraham here, again gives a promise that he will be one who has an incredible lineage. And then we see that God changes his name in verse 5 from Abram, which again means father, or exalted father, to Abraham, which is father of nations. And then we move on to chapter 17, verse 15, and we see that Abraham then is told by God that he's going to have a name change for Sarai to Sarah. Both mean princess, but one could mean more like my princess, or you know, it's a variation on the word princess. And then at verse 16, notice this. It says, I will bless her, and indeed I will give you a son by her. Again, saying the same thing he's been saying, but this is 24 years later. Then I will bless her, and she will be the mother of nations. Kings of people shall come from her. Notice Abraham's response. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, will a child be born to a man 100 years old? And will Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? And Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. But God said, no, but Sarah, your wife, will bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and for his descendants after him. And so Abraham laughs. Now, this laugh, I believe, is not a laugh of scorn or disdain or disbelief. I think it's like, oh, yes, praise the Lord. You know, he's, in a sense, he's rejoicing, because you don't see any condemnation on God's part for his laughter, which we will get to here in just a second with Sarah's laughter. But it's a laughter of joy, and it's a laughter of encouragement. that this is going to happen. So he's continuing to be encouraged in his faith that this is going to happen, even 24 and predicted 25 years after he was originally given this. Now let's turn to chapter 18, and we're going to see the third point that I want us to bring home. And this is probably the biggest and most important of all of the points that we see in Sarah's life that can reflect to us. In chapter 18, we see the Lord appearing to them again. It says, the Lord came to them, verse 1, by the oaks of Mamre, which he was sitting at the tent of the door in the heat of the day. And it says, Abraham lifted up his eyes, and he looked, and behold, three men were standing opposite him. So somehow the Lord and two angels, we don't know, it doesn't say, but in the midst of those three men, the Lord was there. And because Abraham says, my Lord, if I found favor in your sight, please do not pass your servant by. So what he does, he invites him in for some dinner, and he tells Sarah, hey, get some victuals cooking on the stove, and let's have a dinner for these guys and take care of them. And so notice as we get to verse 9, the third point that I want to bring up to you about Sarah's life is that we can lose hope and forget that our Heavenly Father is a God of promise. We can lose hope and forget that the God of our Father, or the God of our Heavenly Father, is the God of promise. Notice what happens starting at verse 9. Then they said to him, where is Sarah, your wife? It's interesting they knew her name. We're not sure. I mean, Abraham may have not said her name before in their presence, but the Lord knew her name. And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, I will surely return to you this time next year, and behold, Sarah, your wife, shall live and have a son. And notice this, and Sarah was listening at the door. She was eavesdropping. She was listening at the tent door, which was behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years, and Sarah was past childbearing. Well, we know that, but it's just reiterated, knowing that she was old. Things had changed in her life, and she can no longer bear a child. But notice in verse 12, and Sarah laughed to herself. This is the second time we see laughter in these passages. She laughed to herself. After I become an old woman, shall I have the pleasure, my Lord, of being so old? And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I indeed bear a child when I am old? And notice this. This is so important. Is anything too difficult for the Lord? Is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I shall return to you at the time next year, and Sarah shall have a son. But then notice this. Sarah denied it, however, saying, I didn't laugh, for she was afraid. She'd been caught. She got caught in her disbelief and said, no, but you did laugh. So I want you to think about this. Sarah, now 24, almost 25 years since the initial promise, has been waiting a long time. And how many times have they tried to have a child and nothing has happened? And how long has she gone with this? I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. I mean, they compromised by giving Hagar. And now, a little bit later, she's now hearing it again and going, no, no, no. I don't believe God can do this. This is all a lie. This is all a hoax. This is a farce. God, you can't do this. How have we done this in our own lives? I mean, we may not say that. We may not laugh like Sarah laughed at God, but we may think it. And we may wonder, what are you up to, God? Can you even do what you say you're going to do? Can you get me out of this situation? Can you deliver me? Can you provide for me the way I think you should or could provide? I just don't believe that you can, and then you can fill in the blank. You see, it's anything too difficult for God. See, what is impossible in yours and mine life right now? What are things that you think you're going through that you just don't think you can tackle? God, you don't know my weaknesses. You don't know the person I'm living with. You just don't understand my situation, and I don't believe you can help me. And, you know, that leads us to a host of decisions that then may lead us down a very dark and difficult path. But when we don't think we can overcome, you know, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world is a simple promise that we know is the case, but do we believe that? And do we believe that God who promises that he's going to give us strength? 1 Corinthians 10:13, there is no temptation that's overtaken you and I that such as is common to man. And God is faithful, and he will deliver you beyond, in helping you beyond which, you know, the situation or the circumstances we're in, and will take us out of that. That's a promise. Do we believe that? And do we believe that our Father, our Heavenly Father, is a God of promise? And so as we kind of summarize these three things that we just dealt with in terms of Sarah's life, I can only imagine that this one of all, Sarah's challenging, if you want to call it that, challenging God, I mean, her laughter wasn't directly saying, I don't believe you, but it was really a lack of faith on her part to think that this is actually going to happen, or this is God's capable of doing this. I want to bring us to some thoughts that I believe will help us to gain hope and gain victory in our lives when it comes to this. First of all, Jeremiah 32:17 kind of summarizes the same thing that has been said to Sarah: is anything too difficult for the Lord? Notice what Jeremiah 32:17 says. Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and your outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for you. And so when we think about it, if God can create the heavens and the earth, when God can do all these great and unimaginable things that are so beyond our capability of understanding, why would we doubt that he can take care of a small, minute person like you or me? Nothing is too difficult for you. You realize Mary had to be encouraged in the same way when she was given the vision from the angel about the impending birth of the son through her, a virgin. It says, Mary said, this is Luke chapter 1, verse 34 to 37. It says, Mary said to the angel, how can this be since I'm a virgin? And the angel said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. And behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age. And she, who is called barren, is now in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God. See, he caused a miracle in Elizabeth's life. He's going to cause a miracle in Mary's life. And God can do these things because he said he would. Even in Jesus' own words about salvation. Now, mind you, this is another aspect of the miracle of God and his grace and mercy, calling us and saving us, all of us dirty, rotten sinners, and giving us the ability to even say we're saved. Notice what was said here in Mark chapter 10, verse 26 and 27, when the disciples were even more astonished and said to Jesus, then who can be saved? And looking at them, Jesus said, with people, it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. All things are possible with God. I just can't underscore that enough. Now, let's get to the finish line here in Sarah's life in terms of this package of waiting, and move us on to chapter 21. Notice chapter 21, starting at verse 1. It said, then the Lord took note of Sarah, as he said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. There's that word promise again. So Sarah conceived and bore a son to Abraham in his old age at the appointed time. See, appointed time, God's perfect timing, 25 years later. God had a reason. It's appointed time, and they had to wait till the appointed time to which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore to him, Isaac. he laughs. Isaac means he laughs. Abraham laughed. Sarah laughed. Two different kind of laughs, but they both laughed. And notice we'll see some more laughter here in a minute. Then Abraham circumcised Isaac, his son, when he was 8 years old, 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Now Abraham was 100 years old when Isaac, his son, was born. That's 25 years later. Man. And Sarah said, God has made laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. Oh, so, you know, she is so happy in this latter time that she has finally seen God come faithful to her and to him and to make this work for them. It's such an amazing final climax, you might say, that she says this in such rejoicing terms and such celebrative, she is so happy that God has given her a son. Now, Tracy and I, my wife, have a similar story. And though God didn't specifically say, Brian, you will have a child, but we wanted a child. Certainly we desired to have children, and we waited a number of years to have children because I was in school. But during that time, Tracy became pregnant, not by our own design, but she became pregnant, and she had a miscarriage. And of course, that was extremely difficult for both of us, but certainly for Tracy in that. And then when it was time, when we believed it was time, after school was over, we started trying to have children. And she couldn't. And we tried. Then we went to the doctor and we started fertility treatments and continued to try. And things just weren't working. And so we were in between a time when we were going to shift to a different kind of hormonal therapy for Tracy to try to see if she could have a child. So we were in a, you know, when we weren't in a season of man's operation here, and this is where it was a God thing. Tracy got pregnant. We weren't on any kind of treatment for her, and she miraculously, I believe it was miraculously, had a conception, and we were so happy and excited, but of course we were concerned because she had a miscarriage. Will this happen again? But it didn't, and we had a child. We had Emily, our firstborn, and then we had another. And Elise, our secondborn. And then we had another, Olivia, our thirdborn. And all of those children were born without human intervention, meaning we didn't have any medication that was requiring something to change in her life to get her pregnant. And we were so blessed. I just got to share a picture here of our, hope you can see this, of our three children. This is Emily on the right, and then Olivia in the middle, and Annalise. We've been so blessed with beautiful children that were, in a sense, by God's miraculous design, as far as I'm concerned, that God blessed us in this way. And so we're so thankful. And, Tracy was a Sarah. we looked at that way, and we still look at it that way, that what an amazing thing that God did for us. And we are so thankful. But where does this leave us? How do we sum all of this up? Go to Romans chapter 4, because Romans, in Paul's work in writing about justification by faith, talks about Abraham. And in this case, we can say he talked about Sarah, his wife, as well. Starting at verse 19 to verse 21, notice what it says. Without becoming weak in faith, he, Abraham, contemplated his own body, now good as dead since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Yet with respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully assured that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. He was able also to perform. You see, the promise was given, and it was going to take place. How do you see God's promises for you, and how do you stay firm and stay put in your relationship with God and in the circumstances that surrounding you, despite what's going on, and going, I don't know. I don't know. You see, Sarah waited for her promise-keeping God. How can you and I wait for our promise-keeping God? Jeremiah 29:11-13 say this, and you're probably familiar with these verses, but these are some of those hallmark verses that just help us to know that God is for us. He says in verse 11 of 29, "For I know the plans, which include promises, that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me, and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart." Hallelujah. God's plan, his promises are for each one of us. Each one of us who know him. Each one of us who call on him. And when we seek him and search for him, we will find these things happening, and we will watch an operational God in our life, and we can see the answers to prayer, and we can see him work. Now, sometimes those are seasons of waiting, and that's where it's hard. But then we see his work in operation, and we can give praise and thanks for him and what he does. Psalm 27:14 says, "Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage." Yes, wait for the Lord. It's hard to wait. It's hard to wait. But it's a lot easier to wait when I know that the Almighty God is taking care of me. I've often thought about this, and maybe this is a strange way of looking. I wish I could look behind the veil and see God operating. Meaning, you know, things are going on around us, and we have no clue. We have absolutely no clue where the angels are. We have no idea where the demons are. We have no idea what God's trying to do through his Holy Spirit. And certainly the sovereignty of God that's shaping and molding us, and that he says he calls us the apple of his eye, and that he's got us in the palm of his hand. You know, those seem metaphorical, but that's really saying God's got us. That means his plan is shaping us and working us. And so I'd love to know what that looks like. It probably is too overwhelming, just like Paul in Corinthians when he got the vision, and then he basically was humbled, you might say, afterwards. And we realize that sometimes when we see great things, it's hard to do. And so maybe we should just be thankful for what we do know and what we do see. But notice Psalm 30, verse 20-22. It says, "Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield." Even when we can't see it, he's there. His help, his shield is with us. "For our hearts shall rejoice in him, because we trust in his holy name. Let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us, according as we have hope in thee." Don't lose security in God to take care of you. He has you in his grip along the way. Don't try to figure out on your own or compromise God's will for your life. If God is in it, he will make a way when there even doesn't seem to be a way. Don't lose hope and forget that God, our Heavenly Father, is a God of promise. Maybe you're familiar with this term, but it's God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. You know, God has said that he is a God of promise and he has plans for us. I want to believe it, but sometimes I struggle sometimes with my faith in truly believing that. And does it settle it? It should settle it, but sometimes we waver, don't we? Just like Sarah, we waver. A couple more verses here in a song, and I just want you to put this in your own life and see how you believe this to be true. In Ephesians 3, verse 20, it says, "Now to him, God, who is able to do far more abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us." You see, I think there's things for us that we could be doing, things that we should be engaged in that are so beyond our even thinking possibility-wise that God wants for us. And it's our faith that sometimes is the lacking element to get to that point, that God is able to do above and beyond all that we could ask or imagine in our life. I want to close with this hymn, "Standing on the Promises." Maybe you've heard it, maybe you haven't. But let these words be the icing on the cake for what we're trying to say here today. "Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail. By the living word of God, I shall prevail, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fall, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all and all. Standing on the promises of God. Now you and I stand on those promises and wait for our promise-keeping God to fulfill his purpose and plan in our life.
Thank you, Brian. Brian pulls out a number of questions from the life of Sarah, but I think actually the most important question he asks is anything too hard for the Lord? You know, we know the answer, but sometimes we need to wait on a reply. And I feel that sometimes it's easy to say it, isn't it? It's easy just to say, is anything too hard for the Lord? But to live it out is actually so much harder. And it usually means a time of waiting. So as we worship Jesus, let us determined to receive by faith the truth he, Father God, has spoken, so that we can keep trusting in him. What he spoke to Jeremiah in chapter 29 is for us as well. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me. Then you will seek me with all of your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord.
The hair that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior meant to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty. The radiance of perfect love now shines for all to
Let's wrap up with our closing blessing. May the assured love of the Father keep you as you wait on his promises. May Jesus continually encourage and guide you in all truth. And may the Holy Spirit give you the divine power you need to live fully for him during this period of waiting. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us. I do hope you have a great week. And I'll see you next week. God bless and goodbye.